And welcome to ETF Edge, your go-to place for everything exchange-traded funds. I'm your host, Bob Pisani, joined today by Rick Edelman of Edelman Financial and Tom Lydon of ETFTrends.com. Markets are bracing for earnings as the season gets underway. How exactly should you play earnings? Moving on here, let's talk to everybody here. Tom Lydon is here with us, talking about the markets and about earnings in general. Rick Edelman is here as well. Tom, I have to say, there are ways to play ETFs and earnings, but it's a little tough figuring out the outperformance part. There's some very interesting ETFs. Let me show you one right now here, and one that I'm finding very interesting, WisdomTree Earnings 500 ETF, EPS. In theory, this sounds like a great idea. Let's go ahead and buy 500 of the largest companies that have generated positive earnings in the past calendar year. And yet, when I look at it, compare it to the S&P 500, they essentially track each other. What's wrong with buying something where the earnings are growing? I thought that's the whole point of the stock market.
It is, Bob. We've had a 10-year bull market in stocks, so the S&P has done quite fine. It's really been tough to beat it. But going forward, I think making an index a little bit more disciplined is a great idea. So now is the time to look at those types of disciplines. And when you look down below large caps and look into mid caps and small caps, that's where we're really going to see the difference. So WisdomTree has a whole suite of ETFs there that has that strategy. And going forward, like you said, you want to make sure the companies you're invested in continue to produce their earnings, even late cycle.
Rick, buying companies whose earnings are increasing is just another one of those quality plays that we've talked about in the past. And in theory, it's certainly a good idea. That, along with companies that are buying back stock, in theory, is a good idea.
No question.
Is it worth looking for that kind of play?
It makes a lot of sense. Quality wins in the long run. Another one is the ProShares Quality Dividend Fund, OUSA, which adds a dividend feature to it, and not just buying companies with strong earnings, but also those that pay dividends, on the attitude that half the profits from the stock market come from dividends, not merely growth in share price. So it makes sense in the long run, even though it might not outperform at a given moment. ProShares hasn't done as well as the S&P, neither has the WisdomTree Fund, but so what? At the moment, isn't a reason to invest or not invest. The long-term focus, buying quality, long-term makes a lot of sense.
So there are other ways to do this. We have one called the PKW that's been out there for a number of years. These companies are, these actually try to pick individual companies that are actually building up 5% of their outstanding shares in the previous 12 months. So here's a buyback attempt.
Yeah.
And yet I don't find it particularly outperforming most of the time as well. But that makes sense to me as well. It's just a play here. There's the PKW, or major holders, 5% of Oracle, Cisco, Citi, Union Pacific. These are companies, and Apple is the big buyback monster. In theory, if you buy back 5% of your shares each year, all other things being equal, your earnings are better by 5%, all other things being equal. That makes some sense.
It does. And today was a great example. Citi released their earnings. They're a big buyback monster as well. So I think, Bob, what you're bringing up, it's a great point. As we're here at all-time highs, everybody's feeling pretty comfortable with the market. Rick, as you point out, going forward, if you feel like we might be a little bit long in the tooth with the markets, make sure you're looking for dividend plays. Make sure you're looking for earnings plays, because these ETFs can actually do that work for you without just buying the general
markets. Yeah, the important thing, I think, is it makes some sense to see it, and yet it's amazing. There's only a fairly small group of companies that are really aggressively buying back. Apple is the big one. They're a significant part of the overall buyback business, and yet they are the largest single buyers of their own shares. There's a small group of companies.
Yeah, so what does that tell you? They're confident in their future, which is great. They're putting the money where their mouth is. Being able to make sure that you have those types of companies in an index, it's very easy with one single ticker.
Yeah. But I think that the notion of focusing on buybacks isn't as effective as focusing on dividend growth, and earnings growth. Because let's face it, it's a hometown bias. If every CEO in the S&P 500 is deciding to buy back their own shares, they're basically saying our stock is better than the other 499. They're all saying this. They all can't be right. So that's an artificial manipulation done in the boardroom. I'd rather see them focus on growing their business. That's how you get earnings to grow. That's how you get dividends to grow. And that's, I think, a better barometer.
But what does it tell you that a lot of companies think it's more worthwhile, even than giving increased dividend, let alone capital investment? Why are they buying back? There must be some logic to that they must believe that it works.
It's simply investor psychology. And investors would rather have the stock go up by 5% than get a dividend of 5% because of taxes.
Yeah.
So there's a psychological element to this, but that doesn't mean in the long run it's sustainable.
Yeah. We're going to be talking to Simeon Hyman from ProShares. They have the Aristocrats ETFs, which, again, over a 25-year period of time, those that continue to increase their dividends over a period of time, it's lightning compared to the rest of the market. So it's all about discipline.
Okay, let's move on here. Go, Simeon's here. Let's talk about Amazon. They're kicking off Prime Day. It's two-day online shopping bonanza. Amazon is the king of online retailer. There are a few online retail ETFs that may be worth adding to your cart. Let's talk to a guy who's got some. Simeon Hyman of ProShares joining us now. Been
How are you?
Known Simeon a long time, and it's amazing to me we give so much publicity to Amazon on a day like today. It's almost like, you know, it's free publicity for Amazon. But you have some interesting ETFs associated with retail. ONLN's been around for about a year now. Tell us what's in this here.
Yeah, so ONLN is our ProShares Online Retail Index, and it's exactly as it's described. It's online retailers. Scale matters, as you mentioned, so it's modified market cap weight. Amazon's 24%, Alibaba's 12%, and it really captures the market. If you look at what happened year to date, so a pretty good environment. Consumer discretionary sector is up 27%, but if you look at the S&P Retail Select Index, it's only up 6% because there are haves and have-nots. Yeah. The online retailers, ProShares Online Retail Index and OLNN is up 27. We also have a brick and mortar index to track the losers of the game, and they're down 3% this year.
But and yet you don't have a problem with the fact that Amazon is 24% and Alibaba is another 12 or 13. You got two companies, I mean, look at these numbers here, well, 21 and 11, that are 35% of the index.
Because number one, it's winner take all in the online space. Scale is everything. Number two, it's a lot more diversified than just buying Amazon.
Because of the others that are involved.
Exactly.
So you've got Chewy in there, you've got a whole bunch
of
other
ones. Chewy just got added right after the IPO, so there are a lot of other names. But indeed, we do think it's important to focus on the big folks.
Yeah. Tom, where do you fit in on buying retail ETFs? I want to talk about his long short retail ETFs that's out there, but it's been a rough ride for the retailers.
It's been a rough ride.
There's been one or two winners, and you just brought them up.
Yeah, you and I have talked about this before. When we were growing up, we used to go to the mall. We don't do that anymore. Every day, we have boxes showing up at our house. Yeah. And if you want to get something, it's so time efficient. But the crazy thing that I don't believe is only 12% of retail buying in the U.S. is done online. We've got a huge amount of upside.
Right. And so I'm concerned that this is a backwards-looking idea, that because of the trend we all see with retail stores closing and with Amazon and other online retailers doing really well, there's an assumption that this trend is going to continue, translating into superior profits for the online retailers and subpar profits, even losses, for the brick and mortars. I'm not sure that's a winning argument over the next 3 to 5 years. So this is a bet. There's no question about it.
Well, let me
this
show
is the kind of stock you should.
I want to get into this right now.
Years ago, not now.
You have a very interesting contra play here, CLIX, CLIX, where you're essentially going long the online retailers and shorting the brick and mortar stores, 50%
short. That's exactly right. So I'm going to counter
stores.
That a little bit, obviously, because, you know, we think, Tom hit it right. It's 10% of sales are online in the U.S., about 12% globally. There is a long way to go and a lot of pain to be had on the brick and mortar side. We're really in the early innings. The e-commerce report that came out just a month ago showed the 10% U.S. online share. It also showed that online retail grew at 5 times the rate of brick and mortar. So even if we only get to 25 or 30%, online retail as a share of overall, we're only 1/3 of the way there. And guess what? Amazon's only 1/3 of the size of Walmart. So from our perspective, it's in full swing, but really early.
But why aren't bricks, to Rick's point, why aren't bricks and mortars, some of them are clearly going to be winners. They're not going to necessarily go away. Is it that simple to say that Amazon's going to win virtually everything?
So there are 2 points. First of all, on the brick and mortar side, we equally weight the index, importantly, because a couple of them will win. So therefore, you know, you equally weight, and Best Buy does well, so what? It's equally weighted in the short basket of the index. The other point is that even as the legacy players generate some online sales, Walmart is a great example. 37% growth in their online business in Q1. You know what happened to their overall earnings? Minus 1%. The chief revenue officer for online just hit the road. They can't make money. It's better than going out of business, but it's much worse economics than they used to have. So from our perspective, still a long way to go.
Before I let you go, ProShares is sort of the leader in leverage and inverse ETFs. And I like to say that this is only a very tiny part of the overall market, maybe 2%. But it's a very big part of the controversies associated with leverage and ETFs. Some people are arguing that because of the nature of leverage and ETFs, leverage and inverse ETFs, particularly because of the reset every day, it's difficult for consumers to get their heads around this, and perhaps it should be included as a separate category, maybe something other besides ETFs. How do you feel about that, and how do you feel about explaining to the consumer what goes on in leverage and inverse?
I don't have any views on the regulatory aspect, but from an educational aspect, we think it's critically important that people understand how they work. We have a ton of educational material on our website, and indeed, the reset is important. You're absolutely right. The multiples on them reset every day. It's the only way it can work.
Yeah.
You can't wake up in the morning and go, oh, this is the minus 1.35 fund.
Yeah.
You have to know what it
Rick,
is.
Rick, you're the biggest registered investment advisor in the country. What do you tell your clients about leverage and inverse products?
They should be avoided because most ordinary investors aren't looking at a daily activity. You know, what happened today isn't relative to them. They're saving for college or retirement, which is decades away. So it's simply an inappropriate vehicle. And that's why I'm in the camp of saying it shouldn't be called an ETF. It should be called an ETL or an ETI, just to help distinguish it from other types of investments. Because although ProShares is doing a lot of good effort in education on your site, a lot of folks come upon these because they see them listed or referenced in consumer magazines or on elsewhere on the internet or referenced in other conversation, and they lose the educational opportunity that would help them understand the nature of these investments. If you call them something different, it'll help convey the message, this is not your ordinary everyday ETF.
Maybe not an ETF, an ET whatever, something
else. They're not for the average investor, but I gotta say, financial advisors continue to use them in a very responsible way. They've become very educated. And from a strategy standpoint, hedging standpoint, there's a ton more choice. Again, they're watching it every day. Yeah. You just can't buy it and forget
about it. I'm very split on this. I agree that there are niches for professional traders, but it is very confusing to explain to the average investor, and that's why I don't do them a lot on air. It's just difficult to explain the reset every day and the issues that are involved in that. So I'm sort of in the middle of all of that. Thanks very much, gentlemen. Really appreciate it. And that does it for this week's ETF Edge. I'm Bob Pisani. My thanks to Tom and to Rick and to Simeon for joining us today, and thank you for watching. You can find all of our latest videos right here on our website, etfedge.cnbc.com. We'll see you next Monday, same time, same place. Have a good week.
Get the ABCs of ETFs with the ETF Edge newsletter, your weekly update on the hottest trends in the nearly $4 trillion market of exchange-traded funds. Expert analysis, actionable ideas, and exclusive insight from host Bob Pisani. Sign up now at cnbc.com/ETF Edge newsletter.